We've come today at the invitation of Mackenzie and Josh to share in the joy of their wedding. A wedding is an outward celebration of an inward devotion that a couple have for one another. And it's that devotion that has led Mackenzie and Josh to join hands in the covenant of marriage. The Bible says that God loves us and created us to love others. Our lives find completion only as we love and are loved in return. And that's why you're here today, out of love for Josh and Mackenzie. Each of you should know how important you are to them and how much it means that you have come to share in the celebration. You would bow with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and all that it represents. We thank you for Josh and Mackenzie, for their love and commitment to each other, and for all those who have loved and nurtured them to this point in their lives. Father, bless this service today. May it honor you and reveal to us a greater understanding of your magnificent love for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. Josh and Mackenzie, marriage is the clasping of hands, the blending of hearts, and the uniting of two lives as one. And you've come today desiring to be joined in the sacred relationship. So in front of your friends and family, and in the presence of Jesus Christ, I want to ask you both for your consent. First for you, Josh. Josh, will you have this woman to be your wife, to live together in holy covenant of marriage? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, be faithful to her as long as you both shall live? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Mackenzie, will you have this man to be your husband, to live together in the holy covenant of marriage? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him, in sickness and in health, forsaking all others? Be faithful to him as long as you both shall live. If so, answer, I will. Who is giving this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and I.
Great. Today we are witnessing a mathematical miracle. Only God has the ability to make 1 + 1 = 1. Josh and Mackenzie, today as we see in the book of Matthew chapter 19, you are no longer two but one. In a world that advocates individualism, you are giving up your individual goals, dreams, and aspirations for something better, and that's the other person. And one of the reasons that so many marriages fall apart is because one or both spouses didn't understand that 1 + 1 in marriage equals one. They lived as though they are two and not one, and in that kind of marriage, one of you is bound to get in the way of the other. And so today, it's as much of a funeral as it is a wedding. Today, you lay to rest your individual lives and become united to one another. Today, your goals, dreams, and aspirations merge together and become shared. In a marriage, as God intended, you become together what you could never be individually. God knew this. It's why he created a suitable helper for Adam, and it's why he has given us the gift of the institution of marriage. I want to read a passage from Colossians 3. It's not specific to marriage, but rather a general guide to all of us and how we should treat other people. And if you would honor Paul's simple yet challenging instructions, your marriage will be a blessing not only to you, but everyone around you. So verse 12, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Compassion. You'll have bad days because you're one flesh. Whatever breaks your heart breaks the heart of your spouse. Learn how to cheer one another up and to cheer one another on. Josh, you are our biggest cheerleader. Mackenzie, you are his. Compassion means that you are always in each other's corner. Kindness. Kindness is a practical and visible expression of love toward one another. It usually starts with noticing the needs and desires of the other person and then being a blessing to them by seeking to meet those needs and desires. It may look like running a vacuum or bringing home a bottle of wine. It may look like sending the other person out for a night with friends or just giving each other time alone. Humility. The word humility literally means lowliness of mind. It's a heart attitude. While kindness is an outward expression, humility is an inward reality. It's about letting go of your rights and serving the other person. It's about seeking the other person's interest above your own, because that was and is the way of Jesus. Patience. This is something fundamental here. You're not marrying a perfect person. today. So patience is a fundamental practice. The word literally means long-suffering, and it's why so many of us struggle with patience, because we don't like to suffer at all, much less for long. Sometimes we suffer because of love, and the first thing that Paul says about love in 1 Corinthians 13 is that it's patient. So I just want to end the suspense and say, you will disappoint each other. It's what we do as human beings, and even more as married human beings, and maybe especially. It's why clothing yourself with patience isn't a suggestion, it's a commandment. Gentleness. The word is also translated as meekness, which means strength under control. The opposite of gentleness is anger and wrath, which is strength out of control. Not a single married couple will say the main problem in their marriage is that they just don't lose control enough. We sometimes have this false idea that we can say whatever we want to our spouse, but it never ends well. The old saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words never hurt me, is maybe the most untrue phrase in the history of mankind. Broken bones heal over time, but harsh words are rarely forgotten. Proverbs 15 tells us a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Words are powerful. Words control strength with each other. Paul continues in verse 13. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Grace received is grace released. You're going to have some grievances. You're going to forget the milk. You're going to get older and you may forget something more important like an anniversary or a birthday. And when one of you forgets, the other forgives and then forgets. A short memory will do you well in marriage. God has buried your sin as far as the east is from the west. That's how he forgives you. And Paul says that's how you should forgive each other. In verse 14, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Love is the most important piece you put on. It's the summary of all those virtues. It's the garment that holds them all together. Without love, they become distorted and unbalanced. But done with love, they perfectly fulfill what God requires of us in any relationship. The book of Romans, Paul's instructions are to be devoted to one another in love and honor one another above yourselves. There's a lot of challenges in those verses, and it's a tall order. And it's why God has given you his spirit. He not only commands you to love one another, but he has empowered you to love one another. Now I know that you're ready to make this kind of commitment, so join hands and face each other and express your vows of love and devotion. Josh, will you repeat this vow to Mackenzie, saying after me?
I, Josh, take you, Mackenzie.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or worse.
For better or worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and cherish you.
To love and cherish you.
Until we are separated by death.
Until we are separated by death.
As God is my witness.
As God is my witness.
I give you my promise.
I give you my promise.
Mackenzie, will you repeat this vow to Josh, saying after me? I, Mackenzie, take you, Josh.
I, Mackenzie, take you, Josh.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and health.
In sickness and health.
In love and to cherish.
And to love and to cherish.
Until we are separated by death.
Until we are separated by death.
As God is my witness.
As God is my witness.
I give you my promise.
I give you my
Having this kind of love in your hearts, you have chosen to exchange rings as a sign and seal of the vows you're making today. Jake, may I have the rings? Thank you. Thank you. Though small in size, these rings are very large in significance. Made of precious metal, they remind us that it's not cheap, nor common, but costly. Made in a circle, their design tells us that love must never come to an end. It's continuous. So as you wear these rings, they will serve as a reminder of the promises you're making today. Josh, will you take your ring and place it on Mackenzie's third finger on her left hand? And if you'll repeat after me this promise, with this ring,
I seal my promise.
To be your faithful.
And loving husband.
As God is my witness. Mackenzie, will you take the ring for Josh and place it on the third ringer of his left hand? And repeat after me this promise. this ring.
With this ring.
I seal my promise.
I seal my promise.
To be your faithful and loving wife.
To be your faithful and loving wife.
As God is my witness.
As God is my witness.
I'm so honored to be a part of this ceremony today, as I'm sure many of you are, to share in the beginning of a new life for Josh and McKenzie. It's a relationship that was first built on friendship so many years ago when they met in middle school and grew into a friendship later in high school. Their times of going to parks or long drives just talking about life led that friendship into something deeper. A realization that this might be something more and a love for each other was formed. My final thoughts to each of you are as follows. Josh, may you guard well the future of this woman who has committed to you her all. She has paid you the highest compliment within her power to pay. She has left her family and has given up her very name for you, the man she loves. May you ever be true to the confidence and trust she has placed in you. May you be the spiritual leader of your home as God intended. May you love her as Christ loved the church with a self-giving, self-sacrificing love. McKenzie, may you strive in life to keep by your virtues this heart that you have won by your grace. May you be true to your marriage vows and to this man who has made you the queen of his home and of his heart and has endowed you with all of his earthly possessions. He has paid you the highest compliment with his power by giving you the very essence of who he is, his name. May you ever be true to this one who has promised to forsake all others and cleave to you until death. So Josh and McKenzie, now that you have come before us and before God and expressed your desire to be husband and wife, you have shown your love and affection by joining hands, having made promises of faith and devotion each to each other, and have sealed these promises by the giving and receiving of rings. I therefore pronounce that you are husband and wife. What God has joined together, let man not separate. May God bless you and keep you and give you his peace. Josh, you may kiss your bride. So ladies and gentlemen, I now have the distinct honor of introducing to you for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Josh Baker.
Now you're my whole world. I just can't believe the way I feel about you, girl. We'll look back someday at this moment that we're in, and I'll look at you and say, and I thought I loved you. Thought I